Well, hello, and welcome to the very first edition of I Remember Bedford. My name is Alethea Yates, and with me is someone who remembers Bedford better than just about anybody in the world, our current official town historian, John Dodge. Welcome, John.
Thank you. John's
here today to talk about farms. So we've got some pictures to show, and right here we've got one picture showing, and John, tell us what this picture is.
Well, this is the old Woods farm, and then it took over by the Seftons. They first went to Waltham because they were Swiss and they had relatives in Waltham. Then they found a farm for sale in Bedford, so they bought the farm in 1916, just before World War II. And they farmed it for many, many years. And they had 75 acres of land. Their big crop was cows, cattle. They had a team of horses. They had vegetable gardens. They had chickens. And they had a farm stand out in front of the house. And they worked all day, worked so hard. And then Mrs. Sefton on Saturday would bake beans for the neighborhood. And it was just a wonderful old farm. I do remember it. And I married their youngest daughter 11 years ago, Frances. And she passed away 10 years ago also.
So tell us where this farm was.
It's on the Great Road, where the Bedford Shopping Center is today.
So this house stood right on the Great Road.
That's right, right on Great Road, And they were wonderful people, great, great farmers. And they had a wonderful, chickens was another crop they raised. Many chickens. And
now, did they sell their crops right there at a farm stand or send it to Boston?
Mrs. Sefton applied for a truck license to drive.
Yes.
And she was the first woman truck driver to have a license in Massachusetts. So that's so they could go to the Boston market with the vegetables also. So they worked so hard. And during the Depression, many people would come by the farm to work for room and board. And that was just a wonderful thing to do. They were just so good to have people helping them during during the Depression.
How long was the farm in operation? Do you remember?
I'd say from 1916 to 1947 is when they sold it.
Just after World War II.
Yeah, after World War II,
And then what? Did somebody else continue farming, or did
they farmed. The Martinez brothers farmed it for a little while.
Then the Martinez brothers.
Then sold the farm. And that's Martinez had the Blue Ribbon Dairy.
A lot of people in town still remember the Blue Ribbon Dairy. Okay, so let's look at another picture. Oh, this is an aerial view of this of the farm, and you can you took this picture yourself.
No, I loaned an aviator my camera. He took this photograph of my with my camera and film, and I enlarged it, made copies of it. And it shows the, how the farm was and the acreage of the farm. And they also owned the way out to Page Road too.
So if we're looking here, I think this is the Great Road. This is
picture's
a bit dark, but there's the farmhouse we were just looking at. And here are all these fields up and back, all the way back to Page Road,
Page Road,
once.
Yeah.
Quite a bit of acreage. And then there were some other buildings along here.
Yeah, my dad's garage was there, right there.
This one, right there, that was your father's
dad's
garage.
Dad's Ford dealership, He bought the land from Sefton's, too. And down the other corner was a Chevrolet dealer, Mr. Puffer.
Probably this one?
He's a Chevrolet dealer. Later on, it became a Volkswagen dealer there. So I know Great Road quite well.
You sure do, John. So now, this is the Joe Blaine house. And long after the Lanes are gone, the Duttons came along. And what can you tell us about the Duttons?
I knew the Duttons quite well. They were a wonderful, wonderful couple. And they had an idea of having a greenhouse. And what they did, before anything new about the environment and so forth, they dug down about 4 or 5 feet and had the greenhouse down below the ground, so the heat of the ground wouldn't have to take as much heat to heat the greenhouse. And they mostly grew herbs in the greenhouse, so they'd be ready to set out later on. And also tomato plants they raised too. They were a wonderful, wonderful couple. And they had a little barn across the street. And I do remember the, when the barn was in operation across the street from the Joe Blaine house or the Duttons.
So that's not the barn that's there today. This was an old barn and
old
it was across
barn,
the street.
Torn down.
The barn that's there today is a modern reproduction. I think they put it up in 1993 or so.
Well, that's behind the, behind the house.
And that's about where the greenhouses were, I
think. Yeah, that's right. But the barn was across the street on North Road.
The Duttons had their barn across the street on North Road. Yeah, and did they have field crops too? They had cows, I think.
They had cows. No, I think they had maybe one or two cows for their own use, for a team of horses.
Yeah. And did they have apple trees or not?
No. We did have a man who grew apple trees on North Road, was Scotty Bowman. Uh-huh. He had a big orchard, Scotty Bowman. Okay. I do remember him.
Yeah. Oh, very good. Okay, let's see what else we've got here. This is the Eliezer Davis House, known historically, up on Davis Road, where it goes around the bend. And who do you remember up there?
Oh, Herb Clark.
Yeah.
Herb Clark was a good friend of mine. He also, I had the garage and gas station. Mr. Clark, Herb Clark, was the one that bought gasoline from me. So he'd drop down every day to chat with. And he also ran the sawmill on the old Billerica Road.
Yes.
And I remember seeing him with a lot of logs on his truck going out of the sawmill on the Shawshin River, across from Carlton Wool it is today. There was a sawmill. Nice sawmill. I remember it. And there was a dam there. They took the dam down to control the water on the Shawshin River.
Yeah.
But I used to go fishing and skating in that little mill pond as a boy.
And in 47 they blew up the dam, more mill pond.
Yeah.
So up here at the farmhouse here, what did Mr. Clark, did he have animals?
Mostly cows. And he did have a team of horses too.
Yeah.
Every farm in those days before tractors had horses.
And the dairy farmers in town, they mostly, they didn't sell the milk directly to the consumer, did they? They sent it off to be bottled.
But the Seftons had their own dairy route.
And
one day Mrs. Sefton told me about, it was a snowstorm and they were delivering milk on Fletcher Road.
Uh-huh.
She got down near the road, she couldn't turn the buggy sleigh around, so she had to unload the milk, pick up the sleigh and
load
it again so she could get turned around on Fletcher Road delivering milk.
Oh my goodness, gracious. She must have been a strong lady.
She was quite a lady.
So let's see what else we've got. Okay, this was the Fitch Barn, or the Jenks Barn. It was part of the what we call Fitch Tavern property now, but Charles Jenks was running it as a farm. He and his sisters inherited it. And this barn was across the street. It's not there anymore.
That's where the police station is, and the headquarters of the Historical Society.
Yeah, over there at the head of Mudge Way.
That's about where
the barn was.
Yeah, that's right.
So we're seeing some horses here.
And they had a very famous weather vane.
Oh?
It's up to the museum in Vermont now. They tore the barn down, they saved the weather vane.
Oh,
a very famous weather vane.
Yeah.
The Shelburne Museum.
The Shelburne Museum in Burlington, Vermont.
And they had a little cow path. I do remember the cow path is where the two stone walls are still there.
Out in front of the library.
By the library.
The cows could walk out of the barn.
And down there below, they were, before it was all built up, there was a little frog pond. We call it the frog pond.
Yeah, I think we might have a picture of that here. Yep, there it is.
The frog pond. And when I was a boy, probably 10 or 12 years old, I would go get the tadpoles and put them in a big gallon jug and watch the tadpoles grow into frogs. That was a lot of fun.
I bet. So just to get people oriented a little bit, I think it's very hard to see, but I think back here, this was the steeple of the Congregational Church over there in the Great Road. So the Great Road was running along here, and the Jenks House, the Fitch Tavern, was about over there. And then there's the cow path and the pond. So out there now, it's where there are playing fields.
That's right.
Yeah. So what do you remember? There were cows. Did they have any crops or just cows?
Mostly cows.
Did they raise hay to feed the cows?
They had their own hay crop. Mr.
Jenks, Charles Jenks, I guess you could say he was a gentleman farmer. He wasn't really doing the farm work himself.
But I know his nephew or his son, Fred Jenks. Fred Jenks was a great guy.
His nephew.
And two daughters, I think one of the daughters is still maybe living.
Oh.
The Jenks daughter, I'm not sure. They moved to Concord. And I went to school with the Jenks girls.
Oh, you did? Yeah. Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Charles never married, but his brother had children. So, Fred and his brother, I think, inherited the place.
Yeah.
Okay, let's see what else we've got here. This is the McGovern property, and you've told me you took this picture yourself.
Yeah, I did it before the house was torn down. And across from this house, we had a large barn, and what they did is they had cows.
Mm-hmm. Now, this was on Hartwell Road.
On Hartwell Road, uh-huh. And I remember Hartwell Road, you couldn't drive a car through. It was just for the Chippin farm is as far as you could drive in that end. And the other end, you go as far as the McGovern farm, there was a dirt road.
Mm-hmm.
And you could hardly drive a car through there.
Mm-hmm.
And that house was torn down when Raytheon took over the property.
Uh-huh.
And Raytheon's up on the hill there.
Yeah. And I think you mentioned they had a picnic grove there.
People across the street from the farm in the woods, the picnic grove, and we rented out or have picnics there.
Mm-hmm.
From the people from Boston, they had relatives and friends and so forth, and they were Irish, and they always had an Irish picnic all the time.
Yeah, it must have seemed very different from Boston to come way out in the boonies
that's
here.
Right.
They're probably wondering if they've fallen off the edge of the earth.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah, and I think I read somewhere that James Michael Curley, the famous politician from Boston, had come out there and given a talk up the McGovern
Grove.
That's
right, yeah. He also spoke in his town hall here, too.
Right where we are right now.
Yeah,
which
right,
is the old town hall.
As a little boy, I sneaked up the stairs to hear him speak, too.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
He was
1936, he was running for governor.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
He was quite the crowd pleaser. Oh, let's see who else we've got here. Okay, here's some people in a touring car. It's with an open roof, and they're going through a tunnel that's carved in one of the giant redwoods in California. We have this here because this gentleman here with the mustache is Win Fitch, who had a place on Concord Road. So what can you tell us about him?
Win Fitch was a great gentleman. Oh, he was a great guy.
Uh-huh.
And up behind his house, he had the famous sand pits, gravel pits, where they got the clay and dirt to make the Bedford yellow. It was a very famous yellow. A few houses are still painted that same color in town.
Yeah, and that's why some of the buildings, buildings in town are
Mr.
yellow.
Mr. Fitch was stone deaf. He one day he was racing his car so fast he blew the engine apart. And one day he was a terrible driver. And one day his nephew, Charlie Clark, said he drove to New York and back in one day. That was a miracle of the century.
Wow.
A bad, bad driver.
Wow.
But a good guy.
Now, did Win Fitch, he had some horses up at his place, or
no,
what did
mostly,
he have?
No, Win Fitch had mostly cattle.
Cattle, okay.
Yeah.
Was that his main occupation, or was that kind of a sideline?
A gentleman farmer.
But didn't he also have, I don't know, some kind of a day job? I seem to remember. I forget what it was.
He did. I think I don't remember.
But he had a big place up there on Concord Road. Okay, here we have some ladies who are all dressed up. They were officers in the Bedford Grange, and the Bedford Grange was very important organization in town for people who were in farming or agriculture. So pretty much everybody belonged in its heyday. Now, what can you tell us about the Grange?
Oh, the Grange. They were the Grange Hall was for the old Bedford Inn, which was right there instead of town. And as a little boy, I used to go to the silent movies there in that Grange Hall. We called it the Grange Hall.
Yeah.
Actually, it wasn't an inn anymore. The Grange took over the building.
Mm-hmm.
So every Saturday they had movies there.
No.
And also the big highlight in September, they had the Grange Fair.
The Grange Fair,
and
yeah.
Where the farmers would bring the cattle to be judged, the chickens would be judged, the vegetables would be judged, the cream pies would upstairs were made, judged for the ladies and the sewing. It was quite an old-fashioned country fair. I remember it like yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
And the boys were bad in those days, too.
Oh, yes.
So what they did one day, one Grange Fair, one of the boys got some eggs out of the poultry exhibit and dropped it in a man's pocket.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's no problem, but another guy came along and says, "Hey, Bill, how are you?" Broke the egg in the guy's pocket. What do you do with a broken egg in your pocket?
Just slapped him on the side in a friendly way. And
broke
then
the egg.
Went,
broke
oh,
the egg in his pocket.
Oh.
It was a dirty trick. And then one time there was a balcony in the Grange Hall, and they were having an exhibit and judging the cream pies and pies and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the wise guys in town was down below to catch the pie.
Mm-hmm.
One of the boys upstairs in the hall or in the balcony didn't toss the pie. He threw it at him right on the head.
Hit him in the head with the cream pie.
We made a mess. That was a highlight of my day growing up. They had a Ferris wheel and a different thing, merry-go-round. It was a really old-fashioned fair right there. It's where the police station is today.
Yeah, the Grange Hall used to be there.
Where the fire station is now. Yeah,
yeah, they tore it down to make room for the fire station. I wish they kept that building. Well, so they had a lot of room out in the back.
My dad was on the committee to build that fire station.
Oh.
And my dad was a volunteer fire chief in town.
Yes.
$50 a year.
Wow. Maybe,
but
wow.
I used to go to a lot of the fires as I was living home with my dad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Were you able to ride along in the fire truck, or did you have to get there on your own?
No, I just went there and helped mostly wind up the hose after the fire.
Oh.
The hard work.
Yeah. Wow, very good.
Anyway,
did you ever enter anything in a Grange fair?
Yes, I did.
What was that?
We the only exhibitor who did this. We had a crabapple tree in our yard at home. And I grew up and caught a Crescent Avenue and South Road.
Mm-hmm.
We had a crabapple tree, so I shined up about six crabapples,
mm-hmm.
and I got a blue ribbon.
Oh.
And I got a blue ribbon, but I was the only one that had crabapples in the whole fair, so I had
beat
to
out all
it.
The competition.
And on also on Fletcher Road, I don't know if I mentioned before, I had the bike race, did I tell
you? No, I don't think you did.
I won the bike race on Fletcher Road, and I had to go over to Mrs. Comley's house to get my prize, 50 cents, to her house after the Grange Fair.
Oh.
And 50 cents in those days was a lot of money.
Wow.
Buy a lot of ice cream cones for a nickel. Yeah.
Oh, that was Mrs. Comley.
Mrs. Comley.
Now, she was the mother of Jack Comley, who's...
Grandmother.
The grandmother, yeah. He lives down in the Cape
big
now,
families,
but grew up in
yeah.
Bedford.
Yeah, big family of Comleys. Wonderful,
uh-huh.
wonderful people in town. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I think at the time, for a while, they lived in... the Grange Hall, or before it became Grange Hall,
didn't
they live there?
I didn't realize that.
Yeah, yeah, I think they ran the fire signal. They had to mine that.
Yeah, yeah.
So let's see what else we've got here. Oh, this is an aerial view. This is some of the grounds of New England nurseries, and we have rows and rows of trees and shrubs. This was just off Concord Road. So what can you tell us about New England nurseries?
Well, New England nurseries, Mrs. Kierkegaard was the one that started New England nurseries. And then Mr. Brown, we called him Judge Brown, because
mm-hmm.
he was a judge up in New Hampshire before he came to Bedford.
Mm-hmm.
And they had a wonderful family, the Browns. And they took over the New England nurseries, which is still in business. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And they were the parents of Louise Brown, who was
Louise Brown, a town historian, long ago. Yeah.
And she was the mother of John and Nat and Dick Brown.
That's right, yeah, yeah.
And the Brown family still owns New England nurseries.
They're still doing business, yeah.
What are some of your memories up there? I know that you used to go, didn't you go perhaps in the swimming hole that was off of the road from New England nurseries?
Well, we used to go swimming, but I've already talked about swimming. We had a name for it. I won't mention that. We had a swimming hole where boys didn't wear bathing suits. It was way out in the woods, no one knew about it.
And didn't near New England nurseries, they had their own railroad stop, didn't they?
They had their own railroad stop.
They could ship all the shrubs
and things. They were one of the largest nurseries years ago in the East Coast. They were huge. They grew a lot of the shrubbery from seedlings.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So what can you tell us about the Brown family? You must have known Louise Brown.
I knew Louise Brown, and I chummed around with the Brown boys myself.
Of course you knew John Brown pretty well.
John Brown,
No longer with us.
We took a bike trip one time up through the White Mountains.
You did?
Quite experienced with the Brown boys.
So, wow. How did you pedal? You didn't pedal all the way from here, or did you?
All the way up to Washington back, yeah.
From Bedford?
Yeah, we've gone two
weeks.
Wow. We camped along the way.
2 weeks?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah,
they made boys hardy back then, didn't they?
Well, guess so.
I would say so, And I think we might have one more here. No, we're back around to the beginning. But you have lots more that you can tell us about farms. Let's go back to the Sefton farm, because that's such a lovely picture. That beautiful farmhouse, I wish they'd save that.
Just as I mentioned about growing hay in town.
Tell us about growing hay.
Growing hay, one of the big crops in Bedford, growing hay in town.
Mm-hmm.
And they, down there where CVS is today, caught on Loomis Street and Great Road, it was a scale. And what they do is the family would weigh the wagons, see how much before, then afterwards, to see how much hay, so they could charge it, what to sell it for in Boston, because Bedford supplied a lot of the hay for horses in Boston. That's where all the transportation years ago was in Boston, was mostly horses. So hay was a big crop. Chickens, a lot of farmers raised and just chickens in town. R.C. Christie, a great road, had chickens. Tony Iazzi had chickens down there. Tony Iazzi was in Wilwell 1 in the Yankee division. Mm-hmm. And he had a restaurant also, and he called it the YD. That's where the Legion Hall is today. Mm-hmm. And Tony Iazzi was, like I said, in Wilwell 1 in the Yankee division. And, but there was a lot of Mr. Plastridge. Had a chicken farm part-time on Concord Road.
Yeah, Mr. Plastridge on Concord Road.
He also drove the school buses. In those days growing up, we only had two school buses in town. One was Tad Albany and also Archie Plastridge, who worked for my dad in the garage too. And those are olden days. Well, I remember the olden days.
Yes. Now, you mentioned chickens and cows, but also there were a lot of hogs raised in Bedford, weren't there?
Yeah, there were a lot of farmers that raised hogs in town. And there was Mr. Kelly on Howard Road, before you got to the McGovern farm. He had a big farm of raising hogs, and what they would do is they had a truck that would go to Harvard College and pick up the garbage. That's what they fed the hogs on years ago a lot, the garbage from the Harvard College and different places gathered it up. So also, I think I mentioned before about the Douglases had, on where Crosby Road is now, they had a piggery. Hog farm.
It's all an industrial park now.
Yeah, it's all industrial park, but I don't know if I mentioned this before, but they had a fire one day, and my dad went to the fire and one morning, and I think it was 15 hogs burnt to death. So what happened before, my mother didn't know, so my mother cooked pork chops for noontime for dad. And he looked at him and says, "Oh, I can't eat those." You understand why, but then there was quite a few hog farms in town too. You could tell it in the springtime because they all had quite a bit of odor.
Yes. That country air.
Country air. From the hogs.
Well, the Llewellyns had a barn fire. Weren't they up on? Were they on Davis Road?
Davis Road.
I think it was in 71.
That was originally the O'Connor farm.
Okay.
And the O'Connor, Mr. O'Connor, was a part-time gentleman—not a gentleman farmer, part-time farmer. And he had a plumbing supply company here in town, Bedford too. And then he had dairy cows, and the barn caught a fire one time, and they lost the barn because barns are very difficult to put out because it's all open air and. Once it gets started, and it goes like crazy. So it's very hard to save a barn fire.
And they're made of wood, and they're full of hay, and it's
couldn't start
a fire better than that. What about orchards? You mentioned a few people had orchards.
Well, I think I may have mentioned it on North Road. There's I can't think of his name right now. I'm sorry about that.
It's okay.
Appalachian and North Road, and he also supplemented his income. He had a rest home there too.
Was that the Inferreras, or is that somebody else?
No, it was also, I should mention the Inferreras. They were market gardens. They had a stand, and across the street from the Inferreras was the Joe Basili.
Joe Basili,
and they were wonderful farmers, and they had stands and also took the crops to Boston, and the Boston market.
There's still a couple of farm stands on North Road, but neither one of them has been in operation for years. They do serve to remind us about farms in Bedford.
And then there's the on the corner of Carlisle Road and Great North Road is the Kazarians. They were nice people, and they had a nice farm. They had a farm stand also. And further back in the woods was Rasmus Peterson. He had a dairy farm there, way back off the Carlisle Road. And Carlisle Road is where the town dump used to be.
Yeah.
The town had a dump years ago before they had pickup.
Yeah.
And there was a gathering place every Saturday morning for people to go to the dump and sit there for half an hour and talk to people. Like old home week.
And were they burning the trash at that time?
They were burning the trash. So
yeah. I can still remember doing that in Hudson, where I grew up. It was so much fun as a kid. Yeah, you go right there and throw your trash right on the fire.
Yeah.
Can't do that anymore.
Yeah.
Yes. So what about, was anybody growing very much corn?
Yeah, we had people that raised corn. Most of the corn was raised for us for the feeding of the cattle.
Yeah.
And they had silage.
Mm-hmm.
So all these farms had a silo, and they were, that's how they got the silage, and that was part of the feed for the cattle.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But Bedford was quite a farm town, and it was principally just a farm town.
I was growing up in a farm town, and so many people, like I said, during the Depression, raised crops behind the house.
Have a garden back there.
Garden behind the house, and the ladies would do canning, and you know. There's no more pantries anymore, but people would do canning and put them in the pantry, and all year round they would have canned vegetables from the garden. And also, one of the things on everyone were up on Carlisle Road years ago.
Yeah.
And way up behind the Pickman's house was the blueberry bushes.
Ah.
And Mrs. Sefton used to go up there with a 10-quart pail and pick blueberries.
Wow.
And she always had blueberries all winter long for the blueberries she picked up there near the Concord River.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that was a wonderful thing to
now,
do.
Were these the little low
little
blueberries
bush.
No, or the big
bush,
high ones?
High bush.
Bush.
Yeah.
And
also people don't realize that I used to go up to the Concord River and what there were wild cranberries.
Really?
I always had cranberries in our house in the wintertime.
Oh, we
put them up
that.
In the attic to keep them to dry and cool.
Mm-hmm.
And we'd have cranberries all winter long for gathers by the Concord River.
Well, I never knew that.
So Bedford's a great town. It was a great town years ago growing up.
Yes. Yeah. And you were there for so much of it, and you remember so much, and you're willing to share it with us.
My age has something to do with it. I just passed 90, so.
Yes, we had a wonderful party here for you.
That's right, you did.
When you turned 90.
Yeah.
Well, this is great, John. Well, you've got so many more farm stories to tell. We're going to have you come back another time and tell some more of them. You gave me a big, long list of farms that you remembered and had stories to tell. And
I want to tell all these stories before I go. So down the road someday, 10 years from now, they can show them, because the Historical Society has all these discs, and they can be showing them later on.
Yes.
After I go.
Yeah.
And I think it's so important to tell these living history while I'm around. Yeah.
Well, we're really grateful to you for doing that.
Okay.
So thank you for this coming to see us today, and I really look forward to meeting you again and hearing some more about farms in Bedford.
My pleasure.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
Thank you.